My girlfriend James did the same for her heart.
Good morning, all. Welcome to First Christian Church. We are glad you are all here with us this morning. Glad to see your smiling faces. I'm glad you're here with us on this beautiful October morning. I don't know if any of you are all excited as I am, but a week from yesterday, antelope season starts. I'm pretty excited about that. But I did get an antelope tag, so I'm good for that. This Sunday is my favorite Sunday of the month, you know, my favorite weekend of the month, because we have men's breakfast. We had men's breakfast yesterday. Today is potluck, so I'm excited about that to fill my belly. I like eating a lot. I don't like eating a lot. I like eating
a lot.
I don't know how to separate those words. But also, first Sunday of the month is our YouTube Sunday, where we give our volunteers a break, even though our volunteer that does the piano, she is gone. But we like to introduce some new songs or play some different contemporary songs. I don't have any new ones today, so they all should be familiar to us. In your bulletins is a page that says upcoming events. There are some things that are going on, some things that you need to know about that are kind of the month of October. So first thing first is Halloween night. We always pass out candy out here for the kids and kind of let people have hot dogs and hot chocolates and things like that. Hot chocolate, not hot chocolates, but just warm. We like to give out full-size candy bars because we want the kids to remember First Christian Church, right? We want them to be like, oh man, that church was awesome, right? So that's what our goal is. So we need your help in that. If you would like to donate full-size candy bars, we would love for you to donate full-size candy bars. I know Walmart and Sam's Club and maybe Albertsons sell those variety packs. Or if you just wanted to go down to the store and buy like six candy bars and donate that, that would be great. You know, however you want to do it, that would be awesome. Also, if you wanted to give me money to go buy candy bars, that is like a very far down alternative. I would rather you do that and bring it to here to the church. But full-size candy bars would be very much appreciated. Also, our missions committee is going to meet this Tuesday at 7 o'clock here at the church. We'll be down here in the library / sisterhood room. As always, our Wednesday Night Live program is going on, plus our junior senior high youth group.
Tonight is slumber party.
Slumber party, dress appropriate sleepwear, right? Right.
Okay. We're playing games, so you have to be able to move around in your sleepwear.
Yes. Yeah. Like mine is not acceptable, so I have to like wear some pants. Okay. Going too far. All right. Here we go. Anyway, today's potluck. If you brought something, fantastic. If you didn't bring anything and want to join us, we would love for you to join us. There's always plenty of food. I know that my family made two things, so we would love to have you there. Here's one of the main parts. The elders, Terry, Rick, and Bill, have these cards called connection cards. Denise is wanting updated information for all of you, okay? Again, so we can keep track of you, so we can send you things if need be, text you. We would prefer cell phone numbers on phone numbers, but if you have a landline too, we would love that. But it's just a way for us to communicate with you. So Rick, Bill, and Terry are going to pass those out to you now. I would appreciate it that if you guys would hand those out to everyone. Please fill them out in order for us to know. And if you're new today or you're visiting today, you don't have to fill one out, but if you would like to, we would love to have that stuff too. We're not going to force it on anybody, but for our main congregation members, we would love for you to fill those out so we can have that information. And if you have more children than the lines available, you can just add them in there.
Just put your favorite ones on.
I just look at this broad general direction, right? anyway, so if you'll do that and get them just If you wanted to just kind of set them on the table out here or back there as you leave, we sure would appreciate that. If you want to bring them by sometime this week or whatever, that would be fine too. And then there's that. Other than that, I know Sisterhood has a meeting Monday as well, correct? Chris? You have meetings? Yeah, oh, it's right there. I missed it. A little spot. So yeah, that's what's going on and what you can do for us. Also, if you are visiting here for the first time, we also have welcome packets too. There's welcome packets back there, but it'll be the job of our main congregation members to make sure that new people get those. We got some things in there for you as well, but they say welcome on them, and they're there and there just for our main people that know that. I'm not asking anybody visiting to get up and go get one. I would prefer that our congregation members do that. So those are there. There's five back there. There's five up here. So please, if you see somebody new or visiting for the first time, we would love for you guys to grab one of those and give it to your friend or someone else that you know. Okay? I think I got everything, right?
I got something.
Yes, ma'am.
I sent out letters for Wreaths Across America, where you buy a veteran's wreath for the cemetery for our program around Christmas. If you got them from me before, you should be receiving your form that you fill out. If you would like one, just get a hold of me and I can get you one.
Okay.
And then Santa's Mall, I'm revving up for that. So if you got any donated items you want to give away or boxes.
When is Wreaths Across America going to happen?
December 17th.
And Santa's Mall?
December 2nd.
Okay.
I need the wreaths would be cut off on November 23rd.
Okay.
And Santa's Mall will cut off.
Okay. All right, so that's what's going on in our community. Diane is heavily involved in those things, so... We've had people from here go out. I know we had one year where we went out, was it Memorial Day? I think we had like six or seven different families out there from our church.
For flags, and then there's been a lot.
There was a lot out there last year for the wreaths.
For the wreaths, yeah.
Yeah, so.
It was really good last year.
Yeah, we were walking around in muck boots and whatnot,
yeah.
So. Okay, let me pray, and then we'll get to singing some songs. God, I just come to you to thank you so much for this day. And thank you for, Lord, all that you do in our lives, the many blessings you give us, the good things you give us, the wonderful things, the people in our lives, the family here, Lord, that you allow us to be a part of. Thank you so much for that. Lord, I pray that as we move forward, I pray, Lord, that you would just be with us and help guide and direct our steps. Lord, that we would be in your word, that we would study it, and that we would read it. And Lord, that we might be able to hide it in our hearts, that we might not sin against you, Lord. And Father, that we would be able to give an answer for the hope that we have wherever we go. Lord, we do thank you so much for coming and living amongst us and showing us how to live. And Lord, I pray that as we come before you now, Lord, that we would try to our best to model our lives after yours and to love people and to care and to be compassionate, Lord. Father, I pray that as we sing these songs, that we would open our hearts and our minds to what you tell us today. Lord, from the word that will be read, from the word that will be taught, Lord, from meeting at your table, Lord, I pray that you just work in all aspects of that. Father, I just ask that you would just be with us now and help us as we lay it all at your feet this morning. Lord, it's in Jesus' precious holy name that I pray. Amen. Remember, today is YouTube Sunday. Stand, sit, kneel, clap, do whatever you want, but join with us in singing, please. On the backs of your bulletin is our active prayer and praise list that we pray week in and week out for. And in our newsletter, we keep the active cancer list so that you can be praying for them daily or however you feel fit to pray for them. And so we want to know how we can be praying for you today, prayers or praises. So how can we be praying for you today? Lois.
Patrick has decided to keep the house the kids have in Arkansas. He needs the strength to now tear up the living room carpet, redo the bedrooms, and the bathroom ceiling. And he's just about to the point where he's going to end up putting himself in the hospital.
Okay.
And that's just all for Eli.
Yeah, okay. We'll pray that Patrick will have the strength to do what he can do. How's that?
That sounds good.
Okay.
I've got a doctor's appointment at 10 a.m. Thursday.
With the pulmonologist?
Just, so hopefully we can find something out.
Okay. Be praying for Lois's family in Arkansas as her son Patrick is trying to do what he can and that he'll have the strength to do it. And then Lois has her appointment with the breathing doctor, the pulmonologist, on Thursday. So be praying for Lois. Anything else? Jen?
A couple of things. We were able to go up to the ladies' retreat in Lewistown on Friday and yesterday. And there was a small group of us from here, but it was a wonderful time. It was a great time for fellowship and some laughs. And Denise is a champ because she drove us, the three of us up, me, Lois, and her, and just the planning that she has done and that she has been faithfully trying to get this stuff done. I really appreciate all that Denise has done to just keep things going around here. And then I would appreciate prayer for the senior and junior high youth group. I've just been feeling a lot of stirring lately that God's got big plans for the youth here in Fort Benton, and there's some exciting stuff going on, and we've got lots of big things planned for the youth group and lots of fun times, and I just feel like God's got a great opportunity here, and I don't want to let him down.
Right. So Jen's asking us to pray, just praise God for the wonderful ladies' retreat that was in Lewistown, and she wants us to pray to God for appreciation for my wife who keeps things running around here, not only around here, but also in my household as well. She's asking us to pray for the junior senior high youth group. Feels like big things are coming, so keep praying for big things. Eleanor. The Ledgewood family. Okay. Yes, sir.
I give thanks for difficult neighbors who can turn into wonderful neighbors.
Okay.
I like the words to your song, "He Tore the Veil." That's what Jesus does. I like your picture up there. He reaches down from heaven to earth as much as the lead.
That's right. That's right. Anything else? Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to ask for prayers for my Uncle Randall Dobby. He's diagnosed with multiple myeloma.
I'm going to butcher this. Myeloma. Okay. How do you spell his last name?
D-A-V-I-E.
D-A-V-I-E?
I-D.
I-D.
David.
Oh, like David. But it's David?
Yeah.
Okay. Multiple myeloma. Tanya's uncle, correct, has multiple myeloma. So be praying for Randall. Anything else?
The moisture.
Praise for the moisture, absolutely.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
At least in this country, it's been nice, right? Terry.
A couple things. We're able to get Don Seagrave and Kristen. Don's moved to Great Falls to the Ivy. And just prayers that you can accept the situation up there and be comfortable. And then just prayers for Biles as they travel back here next day or so.
Should be home tonight.
Should be home tonight, I guess.
That's right. Anything else? Diane.
I would just like to thank everybody that's been worrying about me and talking to the pastor. Please don't worry about me. I'm just busy and my brother's moving and just help out. So
we're not gonna not worry
I'm
about
good.
You. We're
so
not gonna
thank
not
you
not
all
worry
for
about
loving
you.
Me.
I'll let you know we're worried about you.
Adam, thank you.
Bill.
Well, it's just a praise. You know, we went to the men's breakfast yesterday. The men, some of us got to go from the church, and I really encourage men to make that a priority, to be able to attend those things. It was such a great time, and the little message that was given by one of their, by Mike Dean, it's just a wonderful thing. And I just want to praise everybody for all the prayers. That was one of the things we discussed. What a blessing it is to those receiving the prayer. But it's a blessing for us to be able to pray for someone. Never forget that. It is just as much a blessing for those giving the prayer as receiving.
It is.
So continue in your prayers for everyone. We all so much greatly need it.
Thanks, Bill.
It's a 6 a.m. reminder.
Eleanor?
It's a praise to see Juanita and Barb Hankins here, and yes. Also visitors. Carol has her brother here.
Yeah, it was nice to see faces, yes. Anything else? Nicole?
Okay, it's been a while, but I just realized I didn't update everyone on my health after passing out here at church. I did follow up with my doctor, and based on my few previous labs, she wasn't worried. She's a lot more worried about my blood pressure that we're dealing with, but it's not something that she's concerned about.
Okay.
Okay.
Good. All right.
Nicole had
a spell about 3 weeks ago. She passed out and hit her head a little bit. Thought it was low blood sugar probably or something. She's followed up with the doctor, but she's doing okay. So thanks for your prayers for her. I did see pictures of you guys catching sturgeon though, so that was fun, right? So, anything else? Yes, ma'am. Yeah, Juanita's been had a difficult road here the last couple of months, so thank you for praying for her as well and lifting her up, and she's here with us today, so we're excited.
I'm not out of the woods
yet. Not out of the woods yet, but you look 100 times better than last time I saw you, so anyway, Juanita's here, so thank you for praying for her. Anything else? If you've been paying attention to the national news at all, I know it's a long way away, but Hurricane Ian devastated Florida and the Fort Myers area. Lots of people live there. I have friends that live there, actually, and they've lost everything. So be praying for that area and what's going up the South Carolina coast right now. It's hurricane season for them down there, so be praying for that situation. But be praying for those affected by that hurricane, because it was... I don't know if you guys were watching or not, but it was one of the worst that they've had. It was about as bad as Katrina. So it was pretty devastating. So be praying for the victims and the fallout from that. And so far, there's been, last I heard, it was 77 dead. So lots of lost lives. But be praying for that situation too, please. All right, will you pray with me? Lord God, Heavenly Father, we just come to you. There's a lot on our hearts today, Lord, and I know that we're so thankful that we can come to you, Lord, because the veil is torn, and we can come to you anytime. And Lord, we thank you for that. And Father, we just want to continue to ask that you would be with those that are hurting, those that are far away from here, Lord, the maybe we didn't mention today. But Lord, specifically, we want to lift up Lois's family to you in Arkansas. Continue to pray that you'd be with them. Help Patrick to be able to do what is necessary and him to have the strength to do it. For Lois's doctor's appointment that is coming up this week, Lord, may they figure out what's going on with her. Lord, we just say thank you so much for the wonderful ladies' retreat that the Lewistown Church put on, and we're so thankful that we were able to go and have a few ladies from here go and have a wonderful time. So thank you for that. And thank you for my wonderful wife who keeps things rolling. Lord, we are so thankful that we get to be a part of her life and she's a part of ours. And Lord, I'm just so blessed to be able to call her my wife and my friend. And Lord, just how you keep our household moving. And Lord, she's the backbone that does keep things together, Lord. So thank you for that. I pray, Lord, that she would have the strength to continue to do that, Lord, I guess. Father, I know that you have big plans for the youth group, Lord. We've been preparing for rain for a long time, and Lord, I just pray that you would continue to to bring the rain, and Lord, that we would be prepared to do what's necessary, those that are involved. And Lord, we just thank you for the students that we have, and we're so blessed to have them and be a part of their lives and see their budding faiths. And Lord, we just thank you so much for that. Lord, we just ask that you continue to be with the Ledgewood family. We know that, Lord, that you are not a high priest who doesn't know, Lord, that you are. You have compassion for us. And so when we hurt, you hurt. And so, Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you that you're with the Ledgewood family. Continue to be with them. Lord, we just say thank you so much for answering prayers of all those involved, Lord, for the men's breakfast, for Juanita, for all those things, for Nicole doing well. We're thankful, Lord, that you just give us so many things in our lives. We're thankful for faces that haven't been here in a while, Lord. We love seeing them, and we're thankful that this COVID stuff is kind of going away, and it's given us the opportunity to get back out again and live our lives again, Lord. So we're thankful for that. And Father, just ask that you continue to be with those around us, and for Tanya's uncle. What a terrible thing that is, Lord, to be diagnosed with cancer. It affects a lot of us. And so, Lord, we just ask that you be with him and be with the family. And last, Father, I just ask that you would be with those people in Florida that have been devastated, lost lives, lost livelihoods, lost everything, Lord. And I don't know what it's like. And so, Lord, I just ask that you would give them what they need in this time, that you would allow the governments and whoever is there on the ground helping, that they can help, Lord. And if we feel led to donate, Lord, I pray that we would donate somewhere. Father, we just ask that you would just work on us and help us to remember them in their great time of need. Lord, there's churches down there, there's believers down there, and we want to be with them, Lord, but we know how difficult it is. And so, Lord, we just pray that you'd be with them no matter what it is. And we just ask that you would comfort them through this time. And for those that lost loved ones, Lord, be with them. Help comfort them through that time. Lord, it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So, yeah, if you did feel led to donate, this was not on the top of my mind, but there's an organization called IDES, I-D-E-S, International Disaster Emergency Service. It was a service that I worked with in Indiana. They go all over the world for tragedy, offering meals and water, and they are a faith-based Christian organization that is wonderful. We actually work with them with the Wednesday Night Live kids, too. That's the organization that we use to buy chickens and goats and trees and fish and different things like that. So it's called IDES, International Disaster Emergency Service. So if you feel led to donate, I know they're a solid organization, and all money that they get goes to the hurricane relief. So if you feel led to give, look them up online. They're online, so it would be great for you to do that. So anyway, we're going to prepare our hearts for communion time through song. So.
In Luke 22:15-19, it says this: When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, I eagerly desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it and again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, Take this and divide among you, for I tell you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God has come. And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. As we come to this time, this is not a supper in which we invite Jesus to be present. It is the Lord's Supper. This is his meal. We do not come to offer something to him. We come because he offers something to us. The communion table is for repentant sinners, not for people who feel they are without sin, nor it is for those who intend to continue in their sin. This supper is for the repentant sinners who are looking to Christ to save them from their sin. The table is spread, and Christ invites us to come and share fellowship with Him. He has set this table before us. He is the center of it all. What He did upon that cross, we remember here, but it is so much more. We don't have to be asking. He is the one who invites us to Him, to partake, to be with Him, to partake of the great, glorious Savior that He is. What more can we ask than to be allowed to come, to partake, to allow the Lord to be in our lives? I hope each and every one of you today, when you partake of these emblems, realize He has invited us. He wants us to partake. He wants to save us. He died so willingly. He gave it all. What more can we ask of a Savior than one who loved me so much to die? Will you please pray with me? Heavenly Father, what a glorious time it is each Sunday when we get to come to this table that you invite us to. Oh, Father, I thank you for giving us your Son. The sacrifice that you made in sending Him, knowing what it would take, His death upon that cross, and His willingness to fulfill that for me, for each and every one of us. Father, as we partake of these emblems this day, each and every one of us gives you all the glory and the honor. We give our Lord and our Savior our great thanks, because without His love, without His dying upon that cross, where would we be? We'd be a lost, lost church. Father, I am so thankful once again for the redemption that comes through our Lord and our Savior. It's in His name I pray. Amen.
again. We are continuing our study on miracles, and we've been looking at different miracles throughout the Bible. Last week we looked at Jonah and the fish, right? And so it's funny because it's funny how the Holy Spirit works. Okay, I am on this series. I have the list of miracles in the Bible. Okay, well, a list of miracles, not all the miracles in the Bible. And I'm jumping back and forth kind of between the Old Testament and the New Testament. Okay, that's kind of what I've been doing. And I've not been tying any of them together, but they seem to be tied together over and over, right? And so it's a great thing. And today's miracle, you know, Jonah did not want to go to Nineveh because they were a gross, disgusting people, right? He didn't want to go to them because they were sinners, and he thought that they were just, they were done, right? They were too far gone. Well, today's miracle is about almost kind of the same thing. But we have to remember what miracles are, right? Miracles are an amazing thing that God does. God comes in and intervenes over the natural order of this universe, okay? This world that we live in. And he intervenes and it kind of takes over, right? And miracles give us a look at God's provisions for us. It gives us a chance to strengthen our faith. It gives us a chance to maybe restore our faith or even begin our faith. I want to share a story with you. When I was probably a Christian for about 8 months, okay? And I think I've shared this miracle with some of you before. I don't know if I've shared it from this pulpit before, but maybe I have. I don't remember. But I want you to know that God works in miracles. I can't explain it. I can't explain why he does sometimes here and other times not here. But I can tell you that God does work in miracles. I've been witness to two of them for sure that I know. I told you about the one, about the little boy, and today I'm going to tell you about the other one. I had been a Christian for about 8 months, and I'd been in a church, and the youth minister who led me to Christ, helped lead me to Christ, was kind of the guy that I looked to, and I was looking for education on Scripture. Well, he felt called by the Lord to go back home to Wisconsin to his family, so he left and went to his family in Wisconsin. And I'm not saying preacher's sons are bad, but this preacher's son was bad, okay? The preacher's son came in and was our youth minister. And he pick and choose who he liked. And if you weren't a part of his little clique, you pretty much were picked on, made fun of. And I was like, you know what? If this is what God is, I want no part of it, okay? And I was really struggling in my faith, and I was really having a hard time. And I wasn't sure God was real. Okay? I'm going to be flat honest with you. I wasn't sure God was real. And I actually was getting to the point where I wanted nothing to do with the church or people or God. Okay? I was borderline going a bad way. Okay? And my mom and I were driving to town one day. And we had a crappy 1988 Chevy conversion van. It was awesome, but it was crappy, okay? The interior was plush still, but the engine wasn't very good, okay? We're driving to town, and the van overheats. And so we pull off the side of the road. My mom gets out, pops the hood. I'm only 15 years old at the time. I don't know much about cars. I still don't know very much. I have people in my life to help me, okay? And we pull over, pop it open, and we're looking at it, we're like, yep, it's hot. You know, steam's rolling out, right, okay? And so my mom decides that she's like, well, you can relieve pressure. I got this pressure relief valve, okay, on the thing. So she lifts it, and it lets a little off, and it breaks. And it was like, well, she's like, well, I've seen my husband, her husband at the time, I've seen him do this before when it was sort of hot, where you open it just a little bit, let it come out. Well, if you know anything about radiators, and when they're really hot, there's a lot of pressure behind them, right? Okay? And so she pops it a little bit, but goes a little bit too far, and it just explodes out of there. hot radiator fluid all over her arm and up in here and on her neck and stuff. And she falls back into traffic. Luckily, there was no cars there. And she scrambles. I grab her, and we kind of scramble back off the side of the road. And I mean, she's just laying on the side of the road, writhing in pain, going, "Oh my gosh!" You know, she's like third-degree burns. Okay, it's bad. Like her skin's peeling away, and she's just crying in pain. And I'm like, I'm 15 years old. I'm like, I don't know what to do. Okay. She's laying there, and some people stop, and they're trying to comfort her. There's nothing nobody can do, and I'm gonna get emotional, so I'm sorry. I feel helpless, okay? I'm looking at her, and I'm like, "Mom, what do we do?" And she can't speak because she's in so much pain. And so I walk around to the back of the van, and I'll never forget the conversation I had with God. It was the conversation at him, okay? I said, "God, I don't know if you're real or not, but I know that my mom is in pain, and that's real. And if you're real, please stop her pain." That's all I said. I was angry. I walked back out from back in the van, and Mom's sitting up now, and I'm like, "What's going on?" I said, "Mom, how are you feeling?" And she goes, "I'm not in any pain anymore." And I was like, well, you know, I about fell over, you know, dead. But I believe God answered my prayer in that moment.
Amen.
And some nice people filled the radiator up with some water and put it back on. And we drove to town, and she went to the hospital, and she wasn't in any pain the rest of the way. And maybe her nerves were singed. I don't know what it was, but I know that I asked God to take away her pain, and he did. Can I explain it? No, I cannot. Okay, but it was a miracle that from that moment on, it restored my faith. I was on the verge of going away from God. And God broke through and came back into my life. And I can't explain it. I can't explain miracles. I can't explain why God does sometimes and why he doesn't other times. But I know God did in that moment. And it's still unbelievable to me. Mom was laying there writhing in pain. I could hear her while I was praying. And then when I went back around, she was set up and she was fine. Okay? I was witness to that miracle that God restored my faith. And we're going to see how God today, Jesus responded to a leper and restored his faith. Because as a Jew, lepers are the ultimate in uncleanliness, okay? They thought that they were too far gone, that there was nothing we could do for them. And you know, this incident will hopefully leave us with a couple of lessons, okay? One has to do with how we ought to treat those people around us that are less desirable circumstances. And the other lesson I hope that we take away with this is the realization that Jesus is willing to cleanse us from all sin and all unrighteousness, just as he did the leper when he humbly came to him, okay? We're going to be in Mark chapter 1 today. And if you have your Bibles and you want to turn there and read the story, we're going to talk about the first two verses a little bit, and then there's not much after that, but we're going to focus in on the first two verses. In Mark chapter 1, verse 40, it simply says, "A man with leprosy came to him," being Jesus, okay? Here was a man who had leprosy. And we need to understand something about the Bible when it describes leprosy, okay? Both in the Old and the New Testament, the word leprosy was a broad description for skin diseases, a wide range of skin diseases, okay? If you had some sort of rash or something, that would be called leprosy, okay? But the very worst of the condition was known as Hansen's disease, okay? You've probably heard of it, right? Leprosy today is a very, very curable disease if you have access to medicine and things like that, okay? But as we look at this, we're not sure what this man's leprosy was, okay? But we know that it was bad enough that he was desperate enough to break all the rules, okay? Which eludes us to believe that it's one of the worst case scenarios, okay? I want you to understand, I'm going to describe a little bit what leprosy is to you. It's a little graphic, but I just want you to understand what this man was dealing with, okay? It's a horrible disease, all right? It starts with little specks on the eyelids and on the palms of the hands, okay? Then it spreads over the body. It usually bleaches the hair white. It covers the skin with scales and oozing sores, okay? Pretty gross. But that's just the surface. Down under the skin, leprosy begins to eat away at the nerves, okay? And you begin to lose feeling and all feelings of touch in your fingers and toes and hands and feet first, okay? And then it eventually spreads to your arms and legs. So a leper cannot feel anything. And without the sense of touch or pain, you know that you could hit your finger, kick your foot, and lots of things back then when they wore sandals. You get an infection easily, right? Gangrene sets in, all that stuff, okay? It's a bad deal. And eventually what happens when body parts start rotting, they start falling off, okay? Bad, bad deal, okay? So this is where it could advance to. And leprosy would also cause blindness, and they would get ulcerated growths on their face, and it was just a bad, bad deal. And nobody actually wanted to be around these people because they were hard to look at, okay? In worst case scenarios, they were hard to look at. And this might be what Jesus was dealing with today. This man might have been on the brink of going blind. He could have lost some limbs or was getting close to losing limbs. We don't know. But the way the man approaches Jesus alludes to the fact that it was a desperate situation. But let me pray, and then we'll dive a little bit further in. God, I just come to you to thank you for your word. Thank you for your provision in our lives, your miracles that you sometimes reveal to us. Lord, thank you for that day that you restored my faith. Lord, I pray that as we see how Jesus restored this man's faith, I pray that you would help us to see and learn from it and to use it to preach the word wherever we go. Lord, we love you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So leprosy, even though leprosy was like looked down upon, it is not a highly contagious disease when one person would have it, okay? You get it in various ways. And today, again, like I said, it could be treated with drugs and it could be cured. You don't have to worry about it. But in the Old Testament, God set some very strict instructions for them because there were some various contagious skin diseases, okay? But the Israelites took it really far and didn't quite understand things. But we need to understand that as a society that Jesus lived in, it was the same. And it was even worse because the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the religious leaders went even further than they were supposed to, right? And so as there were boundaries for this disease, what they were to do, okay? And in the book of Leviticus, it tells us that a person with leprosy and was unclean, okay? If they were unclean, they were not welcome to be a part of God's people. They were not welcome to be a part of God's church back then. They were not welcome to be in the presence of other people. They actually had to go and be somewhere else. And different things of uncleanliness, like a person who touched something dead, okay? They were told to go outside the camp for a day, wash that evening, and then go to the priest, and they would be clean, right? Okay, like childbirth was another form of uncleanliness. So you would be unclean and for a while, and then you would come back and you would be clean, okay? But leprosy was different. This type of leprosy was different. It was, as well as all the other serious diseases they dealt with. You see, this form of uncleanliness basically required them to stay away. Leviticus 13:45 and 46 says this: the person with such an infectious disease must wear torn clothes, let his hair be unkempt, cover the lower part of his face, and cry out, "Unclean! Unclean!" As long as he has the infectious disease, he remains unclean. He must live alone, and he must live outside the camp. Okay? Well, again, during this time of Jesus, they didn't just live outside the camp, outside the city. They actually lived way out in the mountains, in caves, because people ran them off, okay? It became so bad that they were so afraid of these people. But every once in a while, you would get them to come down. Now, this leper was to dress like a mourner, like he was going to a funeral for a burial service, keep his face covered, and yell at people as they approached him. Unclean, unclean, right? Not letting anyone get too close. And I'll tell you what, people did keep their distance. They're like, ooh. Right? Ooh, they're gross, right? Just imagine a leper walking down the street. And little children are aghast at their figure. They scream and run away. Older children maybe are a little more harsh. They start throwing rocks or making fun of the person, right? Adults just were like, ew, gross. Wouldn't make eye contact, walk around and walk on the other side of the street, right? A leper had to live in exile from the mainstream of society. He was excluded from all religious festivals, everything. He was not only separated from all of that stuff, all of his family, he was separated from the church, and he felt like he was separated from God. The leper's life was one of isolation, loneliness. Just like the disease itself, the isolation progresses gradually, okay? Think about it. Maybe he's got acquaintances and friends all around, and then they find out he has leprosy, and those acquaintances, they scatter, right? But that close group of friends stays for a little bit, and they start to begin to realize, man, we can't even be around this guy anymore, or this person, and they begin to leave as well. And then the immediate family, they're still there, they're still bringing him food and clothes, but they slowly begin to drop off too, and the only one he's got left is his mom, who might come visit him sometimes now as the disease progresses and he becomes more hideous. Then she stops completely someday. Because nobody wants to look on this disease. Nobody wants to look at this person. Then nobody wants to look at this hideous monstrosity of a person. Nobody does. And as we look at this Mark chapter 1, wonder how long it's been. Wonder how long it's been. Maybe he'd come into town every once in a while as he comes out of his cave and he's been living without love and without hope. And he's lived without the simple dignities of life, being smiled at, being waved at, being greeted on the street, being able to go and buy fresh produce. Understand, they're not allowed to even commerce. They probably went to the garbage dump and got their food, if there was any left. But aside from that, they've not been invited to anything in years. They haven't celebrated any Passovers, which was a huge deal to the Jews. All of this was forbidden forever. But one day he hears, this leper specifically hears that Jesus has come to town. Jesus, the one claiming to be the Son of God, the one who heals the sick, makes the lame walk, causes the blind to see. And so the leper comes. And this is where our story begins. I want to see two things that happen here. One is the approach of the leper. The first one we're going to look at is the approach of the leper. Verse 40 says, a man with leprosy came to him and begged him on his knees. He said, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Notice here something. It's the approach of the leper. It's not Jesus coming to him. Right? The leper comes to Jesus, and this is a huge violation of the rules and regulations concerning how these people were supposed to react, okay? His desperation was very apparent. He said, I'm breaking all the rules, basically, okay? He didn't shout, unclean, unclean, to keep Jesus away. But instead, it's almost like he runs to Jesus. And amazingly, what happens? Jesus doesn't run away from him. He doesn't go, ooh, right? It's not, at least not recorded in Scripture. At no point in Scripture do we see Jesus react in a manner that is unfitting of how God loves us, do we? This man comes to Jesus and says, if you're willing, make me clean. He doesn't say, heal my disease. But rather, if you are willing, make me clean. Why is that important is what you're maybe asking yourself. Why is that so important? This disease has caused great physical distress for this man. But his uncleanliness, which separated him from God's people. Unclean, right? And I believe as I read this, there's a cry in this leper's voice that says, I want to worship. I want to come to the church. I want to be a part of God's people. I want to go to my Passovers. I want to be here. I want to be clean, Lord. Because being clean meant you got to be part of society again. And so what does this leper do? As he approached Jesus, he falls on his knees begging. He doesn't shout unclean. He says, if you're willing. And his words tell us three things. First of all, he knows he cannot heal himself. Okay? He cannot make himself clean. And he's probably never even heard of a leper ever being cured at this point. Remember, this is early in Jesus' ministry. And he's lived with no hope, absolutely helpless, and he knows it. That's the first thing we see in his desperation. Second, there is a faith in Christ's power. He's heard about Jesus. And so he says, you know what? You can. I believe you can. I can't do it, but I think he believes that Jesus can do it. He's the one person who can cleanse him. And third, he has his submission to God's will, right? If you're willing, if it's your will, right? Make me clean. He has no idea if Jesus is willing, right? Again, remember, Jesus is just new to the scene. And he's not sure. He had no idea. But his request shows us a certain level of maturity. Maybe he was a faithful man, but he just could not be a part of it. But he's leaving himself in the hands of God. A submission to God's will. And he makes no other demands. He makes no other requests. And he just says, please, if you're willing, make me clean. And the second thing we see happening here is Jesus' response. 41 and 42 says, filled with compassion, Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. I'm willing, he said, be clean. Immediately, the leprosy left and he was cured. Jesus granted this leper's request, okay? Not slowly or in stages over a number of days like we've seen him do in other places in Scripture, but right then and there, the leprosy left him. Now imagine you're a person that's standing there distance away from this guy. You know, the guy's over there and they're like, ooh, right? They're thinking the worst. And Jesus goes over and touches the dude, right? You're thinking two things. Who does this guy think he is? Or who is this man? Right? And second, maybe he is the Son of God, right? It begins this restoration of faith versus beginning of faith, right, for some people. And this healing is not any different, okay? I want you to understand, it's not any different than other miracles Jesus performed. But there's a couple of things that happen here that I want us to see. First of all, the first thing I want us to see is do not overlook this. Jesus is filled with compassion, okay? It wasn't just that Jesus looked at him and said, you need something and I got it. There you go, right? The word compassion actually suggests a deep feeling, a depth of feeling. It literally means to feel with. And if we look through the Scriptures, we find out that there's 10 times in the Gospels we're told that Jesus had compassion on people around him, okay? What it means is that Jesus hurt when people hurt around him. It bothered him to see people suffering and in need. And it touched his heart when someone came to him and said, please help me. Do not take this for granted. Please do not take it for granted. Remember, the God of all the universe, the God of all power, knowledge, and time, the sovereign God of all, cares. And he feels with us when we hurt. Think about what this man dealt with for a moment, will you? The other religious leaders of the day, the Pharisees, the priests, the Levites, they were more concerned about being religious and enforcing religious customs than caring about people. Remember the story of the Good Samaritan that Jesus tells? Everybody walked on the other side of the street, except for the Samaritan. But Jesus painted a picture of the typical attitude of the day. Nobody cared about these people. Think about it for a moment. In our lives, it's so easy for us not to care. It's over there, right? We see a lot of suffering and pain in this world. And it's easy for us to just kind of do this, right? To become hard and calloused. And I'll tell you what, the God of all compassion cared. Jesus refused to do that. And he still refuses to do that. No matter what your condition is, it doesn't matter if you're clean or unclean, Jesus does not care. I talked with a friend this week. And what we talked about reinforced what we are to do as Christians. Christians, we are in the business of people. We care about people. We are to look out for the best interests of people and share Jesus with them. Remember, we are in the business of people to care. And I am so glad Jesus is too. Look what he says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15 and 16. He says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weakness. But we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin." Verse 16, "Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." Jesus knows what it's like for you to go through what you go through. Jesus cares about you. Jesus wants you to be a part of his family. Jesus cares, and he has compassion, and he's moved with compassion. Did you see what Jesus did after that, after he's filled with compassion? Please tell me you saw. He touched him. When nobody else would, nobody else cared, Jesus touched him. Jesus broke social norms to give this man what he needed. He touched a leper. This man was not only physically unclean, but he was spiritually unclean. And this is the last thing that any Jew would have ever done, was touch this man. Didn't know what it was like. He'd lost everybody in his life. If he was married, his wife didn't even care about him. If he had kids, his kids couldn't hold his hand and say, "Daddy, let's go for a walk." I can't even imagine how that would feel to go through life without having somebody that cares. We have to understand that only one person was allowed to touch this person, the high priest. And he could touch him only when he was healed. And the touch of the priest would pronounce him clean. This spiritual significance is not to be overlooked. This spiritual significance of Jesus being our high priest, like Hebrews 4 tells us. Jesus could have healed this man because we've seen him do it before from a distance. But that is not what the man needed. The man needed to know that people care, and he needed that closeness of another human being. Amen. And what was the result of Jesus' touch? It says immediately the leprosy left him and he was cleansed. He was cured. Other translations say cleansed. Notice that there's two results: healed and cleansed. Okay? He was healed physically of the leprosy, but he was also cleansed spiritually because he was touched by the high priest. And to confirm it, Jesus later in the passage here goes on and says, "Now I want you to go to the high priest and show him that you are healed. So that way society knows that you are back a part of it." And that's what he did. There are some thoughts that I want to leave you with as I'm closing today, okay? As we think about this. First, I want us to come away from this lesson with appreciation for the compassion Jesus showed. And a commitment to be a people of compassion as we deal with the unclean around us. Listen, I am not telling you to rush out and start touching people with infectious diseases because you're not Jesus, okay? It's not what I'm telling you. I understand that there are lots of people in this world that deal with these different things. But to completely cut them off from society is not what God wants us to do. But I suspect you know someone who is suffering just like this leper did. We have people who suffer just as much as people with leprosy did in biblical times. They might not be lepers, but they've been cut off. They've been cast out. They've been treated by so-called church people. I get this conversation a lot, just so you know, that church people have hurt me. I get it. If you've ever talked with somebody who has AIDS or who has cancer or somebody who's mentally or physically handicapped or they live in a nursing home, you likely find that conversation amongst the people is that they suffer, that not from what they're suffering from, but nobody cares. It's the isolation and loneliness, the feeling that nobody wants to be around. And when was the last time somebody made an effort? Here we go, church. This is me too. As the body of Christ, we need to be a people of compassion. It's not just the preacher's job to go out and visit people. Okay? Compassion is the quality that all of us can have. It's a quality that all of us know. Because as a child, we experience compassion with our parents. But for some reason, we tend to push it down when we get older. We see what happens in the news and things around the world, and we just kind of like, it's not my problem, right? We change the channel or we just don't care. Sometimes we stay away from visiting people in hospitals or going to people's funerals or to nursing homes because it's hard for us to see that. In fact, we also stay away from the sick or sinners because we think that they're just a hideous monster. I want you to understand that when Jesus was confronted about eating with sinners, well, his response was. In Luke 5, 31 and 32, he says, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but the sinners to repentance." Hallelujah, right? I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful that he came to me, a sinner, and called me in. And as a result, what am I? What are you? We are Christ's ambassadors in this world. We are to have the same care and compassion that Jesus had. And I realize that we cannot take every personal thing, responsible tragedy, every personal tragedy, or every clinical depression thing. We can't take that. The world hurts, okay? I understand it. But we can affect change where we're at. We cannot afford to shut our eyes off to the people hurting around us. We cannot afford to shut our eyes off to the sick around us. The ones who don't feel like they're good enough for God. We can't cut ourselves off to those people. That's the first thing I want us to come away with. The second thing I want us to come away with is about the stories, the realization that Jesus still has the power to cleanse. In many ways, leprosy is like sin, right? Sin does its worst damage by eating away at us, penetrating deep inside us, causing us to eventually lose all feeling towards anything and everything around us. We try to hide it, and we try to suppress it. We have addictions that we turn to. And we cause ourselves, push ourselves farther away from God. Sin will cause us to be isolated from God's people and from God himself. We run and we try to hide. God is so desperately there wanting us to come back. And eventually, like leprosy, sin will destroy us. And there's nothing we can do to get rid of it. Nothing that you or I can do to get rid of it. Oh, and I'll tell you what, Jesus is waiting there for us. "Come home," he says. He's standing on the porch like the dad, waiting for his lost son to come home. "Come home." And he doesn't scold us. He doesn't reprimand us. But what does he do? He says, "Welcome home. You're cleansed," right? The response of Christ is overwhelming to me. Scripture tells us if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Oh, I am so thankful for Christ. This miracle over leprosy is more about Jesus' willingness to cure us from our sin. Jesus is willing. Are you going to come to him? Will you pray with me? God, I just come to you to thank you for this miracle in this man's life. Lord, I thank you for the miracles in our lives that you give us, Lord, that you would come and find a bum like me, a sinner, a lost sinner, and restore me. Lord, I'm thankful for the faithful saints as well, Lord, that have followed you with all their lives. Lord, maybe we've gotten to a place where we're kind of calloused. Lord, I pray that you would dissolve that callous and help us to begin to see the hurting again and ask, what can we do? Lord, give us the strength. Fill us with your compassion for the lost. And may we be vessels and ambassadors for you wherever we go. Lord, you ask us to preach the word wherever we go. So Lord, I pray that we would. And Lord, that we would help as many people along the way to come to you as that we can. Lord, we throw the net out and let you sort it. But Lord, continue to give us the strength and the courage and the wisdom to do it. Lord, we love you. It's in Jesus' precious and holy name I pray. Amen. Thank you for being here today. We don't have a closing service on YouTube Sunday, but closing song for service. So I just want to tell you thanks for being here. If you're coming to potluck, please come join us downstairs. You can go down those stairs that way, or you can fish your way through the kitchen this way. We would love to have you have some type of fellowship with us, but come and join us. And if not, I hope to see you next week. And thank you for visiting with us if this is your first time too. Anyway, go and love God, love others. Have a great week. Keep your eyes open. Don't shield them to what Jesus is showing you. Go and love God. Yeah.